Hi, this is Graham from Jenham's Astro. Many people want to buy a first telescope for themselves or for a friend or family member, but they don't know which one to choose. I've chosen a scope, the Skywatcher Heritage 130, which I think could be a good option. In the UK, it costs around £140. In the US, a very similar scope is called the AWB Onesky, and it retails for around $200. Now, these aren't new models. They've been around for about 10 years. But that's okay, we're looking for a simple, solid and affordable start in astronomy and not for the latest tech. This video will show what's in the box, and in other videos on my channel we'll see how well the telescope performs. So please press the red subscribe button and let's see how this option works out. Okay, some first observations. The scope comes in a relatively small box. Now that's a good thing. Scopes can often be bulky and hard to store around the house, but not this one. I can lift the box without going to the gym. It weighs under 7 kilos. The part of the scope that gathers the starlight, the mirror, is 130 millimeters or 5 inches across. Now, that's a good size to do the job for a first telescope. But why not get a bigger scope? Well, because the best telescope that you own is the one that you actually use. Large heavy telescopes are bad news for beginners because they just don't get used. Maybe you only have the odd hour or two for your new hobby, or maybe you have to transport the telescope out of the city to see some dark skies. So buy a scope that you can carry, maybe one like this. Let's open up the box. Okay, so inside the box there is a bundle of instruction booklets. So there are three items in here. There's a small guide to astronomical telescopes and astronomy, which is quite useful, gives some general information. There is a booklet that is particularly for this telescope, which gives you some more detailed instructions. And then finally, there's a flyer which includes just some pictures of the latest Skywatcher models. There's a small box of parts. Pretty lightweight. We'll come back to those later. And then finally, there is the telescope itself. So if I unwrap the plastic bag, we can see that out of the box, then the mounting, which is this white part here, and the optical tube, the telescope itself, is pre-assembled, so it's quite straightforward. There isn't a great deal to put together. So if we remove the polystyrene packaging and the foam, then we can loosen off this bolt here, and then we can turn the telescope tube around and we can tighten the bolt again. Now, we also have two small bolts here, one on either side. If we loosen those, then it allows us to extend the tube like this. Now, we tighten the two bolts again, and everything is secure. So, this is the way that we'll look through the telescope. It'll always be extended like this when the telescope's in use. But conveniently, this design allows us to shrink down the telescope so that it takes up a lot less space for storage and transport. Now, this sort of telescope is called a flex tube Dobsonian. Now, the flex tube part really refers to the fact that we can extend the tube, as we've just seen, and the Dobsonian part is taken from the name John Dobson, who's credited with the idea of this type of telescope design. So, first very important thing to notice is there's a warning label which is attached to the telescope, and this is Skywatcher warning you never to look at the sun through a telescope. It's very, very dangerous, never do it. Certainly if you've got a telescope outside during the day, maybe you're preparing to use it later on after the sun goes down, never leave it unattended if there are any children around. It's a very, very important message. So we'll remove this label for now, but we've got to keep that in mind using any telescope. So this particular telescope, if we just turn it around so you can see, we've got a cover which we just turn and pull off front, and then you can see that there are two mirrors. There's a primary mirror at this end here. Light comes in the front, goes to the back of the telescope, reflects off this mirror, and then comes forward again and reflects off a small mirror here, which hopefully you can see. It's called the secondary mirror. And then from that, the starlight comes up through this tube, which is where we'll have an eyepiece, which we'll come to in a minute. So two mirror design, it's a reflector telescope, and really the most important thing to realize is, other than the message about not looking at the sun, the important thing is that you've got to be very careful with these mirrors. Never touch them with your fingers. Also be very careful never to scratch them. Generally they don't need to be cleaned, so just stay away from the mirrors themselves and the telescope will work much better. Okay, that's it. Okay, so the obvious thing to see when you look at this scope is that it isn't very big. It isn't going to sit very high off the ground, so you're going to often need to use it on a table in order that it's a comfortable viewing position when we look through the telescope. Now, this is a slightly unusual arrangement. Most astroscopes sit on the ground, and often they use a tripod to lift them up so that you can view through the telescope when you're standing up. Now, we'll see how easy this particular arrangement is to use in a later video, but the point to remember is this. Yes, you might need to raise it up or perhaps lie on the ground yourself when you're using it, but it's so light that you can set it up and move it around easily. Now, that benefit, I think, will outweigh any disadvantage of having to find some way of lifting it up off the ground. But we'll see how that works out. Remember, if you've got a large telescope that's so heavy you don't move it around, you don't use it, and it gathers dust, then really that was a bad choice of scope. Okay, so going back to the items in this box, one of them is this, which is a thing called a red dot finder. Now, basically, this is a clever little device which allows you to see exactly where your telescope is pointing. So there are a couple of screws on the side, and we'll be able to attach it easily to this position on the side of the tube. Now, the idea is that this is a device that has a magnification of 1, so it doesn't magnify. But you look through a screen, and the red dot finder projects a red dot onto the sky behind, and that allows you to see exactly which way your telescope is pointing. So out of the box, all we have to do is to remove a little plastic tab, and then this red dot finder is supplied with a battery already installed, and all we'll do is turn it on with this little knob here, and then hopefully if I hold it up you should be able to see that there is some red light there. Now, basically, we're going to attach it here and then we'll look through here, and then we'll know by looking at where that red dot appears to be against the background of stars, we'll know which way the telescope's pointing. Why do we need a finder? Well, basically because all telescopes, small ones and large ones, all have a relatively small field of view. It's very difficult, very frustrating to actually find any objects unless you have some clever way of helping you like this. So a red dot finder, it's good to see that's included with the scope, and it's certainly going to help it help us use it more easily. Now, just in case you're unsure, the instruction booklet here contains details of how to attach the red dot finder, as I have done now here. Now, it's very straightforward. It really is the only bit of significant assembly that you have to do. You're just following through a series of pictures. So that's good. We're almost ready to go. The only thing we need to say further about the red dot finder is that you're using it to tell you which way the telescope's pointing. So you're going to need to align this accurately with the way that the telescope is pointing. You only need to do that once, really. And the other feature of the red dot finder is that you've got an adjustment knob to allow you to adjust the finder up and down, and another one under here to adjust it left and right. And that is just to make a one-time alignment of the main telescope tube with the direction that the red dot finder is pointing. So that's something you can do during the day. You can do it before you go outside, just before you first use the telescope. And the only important thing to remember there is, again, if you're going to use a telescope during the day, make sure you do not look at the sun. So I'm going to mention that again. I'm not going to apologize for mentioning it twice. It's the most important safety rule in astronomy. So once you've lined up the red dot finder, then you can just leave it, forget it, and then just use it to make your stargazing a lot easier. So the other item in the box, or items, are these. Now these are the eyepieces. Now eyepieces are small lenses that you attach here on the side of the telescope, and in fact you look through those in order to use the telescope. So two of these are included. Let's have a quick look at these. So the first one is described as a Super 25. Now if we take that out of the box, then you take it out of its packaging bag. It comes with a couple of plastic covers on each end, so you can just take those off. And there you go. So that is what they're calling a Super 25 eyepiece. Now it's got a little plastic guard which you can adjust, or in fact it can just fall off, as it just has demonstrate, but it can be used to you can lift it up like that. There we go, got there in the end. And that is to provide a comfortable way of looking through the eyepiece. So now what does 25 mean? Well, 25 is what they call the focal length of this eyepiece. It means it has a 25 millimeter focal length. Well, what does that matter? Well, really all that's important is that of the two eyepieces that are provided, this one, the 25, is the lower power eyepiece. So in fact, the lower power eyepiece is going to give us a magnification of about 26 with this telescope. So it's quite a lot more than with binoculars. But 26 might not seem very high, but it's going to give you a nice wide field of view. So we'll have a look at the relative field of views you get with these two eyepieces. But the point is that the 25 is probably the most useful of the eyepieces, certainly the one you should use when you start trying to find an object. Start with the low power eyepiece and then move on to the higher power eyepiece when you've found the thing you're looking for. So the higher power eyepiece, described as a Super 10 long eye relief. So eye relief is just a measure of how comfortable the eyepiece is to use, especially if, like me, you wear glasses. So again, take it out of the bag, a couple of plastic covers, and it's called, there you go, Super 10, and it's got another eye shield here, which I'll try to unfurl this time without it falling off. There you go, got the hang of it. So 10 millimeter eyepiece, so this scope is going to provide a magnification of about 65 when we use this eyepiece in here. So basically we'll put that into the focuser here and we will look through the telescope like that. Now what I would say about these eyepieces, people can spend hundreds and hundreds of pounds or dollars on eyepieces when they're really into astronomy. Now obviously for the price of this scope, these are very basic eyepieces, but it's good that two are included, and I'd say that they are enough to get you started. We'll have a look at how they perform in later videos, but probably the important thing to note is start with the bigger one, the 25, which is actually the lower power one. I say it again because it's important that to make a telescope easy to use, you can find the objects you're looking for. So start with this lower power Super 25, as it's called. Start with this eyepiece. Okay, so moving on to the focuser, which is this part of the telescope here. So as we saw, you put the eyepiece, in this case the Super 25, into the focuser, and you tighten up the eyepiece with these two little screws. And then the idea is that you look through the eyepiece and you focus the telescope. So you adjust it like you would with binoculars in order to get the moon or the planet or the star into focus. And on this telescope you make that focus adjustment by turning the focuser like this. And as you can see, as I turn it, then the eyepiece is moving very slightly further away, or if I turn it back the other way, very slightly closer to the mirror. So that's how the adjustment is made on this telescope, and it's called a helical focus because basically that mechanism is moving in a helix. Now, most telescopes use a different sort of mechanism. I've got an example here. So this is a different telescope here, and it moves the focuser in and out on a rack. Now, that is a more conventional mechanism for separating the eyepiece from the front of the telescope. But it doesn't matter. This is a starter scope, so it's equipped with a different type of design. We'll see how it works out in a later video. The only point I'd say to note is don't keep unscrewing it all the way, because this will eventually fall out. If we keep screwing and screwing and screwing, it's coming further and further out, then bingo, falls out. You don't want to do that, because remember, if you drop something inside the tube, it's likely to damage the mirror, in which case you're probably going to need to buy another telescope. Just be a little bit careful, make small adjustments with this focuser, and bear in mind that you do not want to completely unscrew it, but in practice it shouldn't be a problem. So that's everything attached, and we're almost ready to start using the telescope. I just want to make a small mention of a thing called alignment. Now, all telescopes use a combination of mirrors and lenses in order to bring the light from the moon or a planet or the star into focus. And it's important that the optical arrangement of the mirror and the lenses all remains in good alignment in order that you get a nice clear image. Now, if you have any rough treatment of the telescope during transit or just during assembly, then it's possible that the telescope can become misaligned. So these mechanical misalignments are known, astronomers have a word for it, it's called collimation. You need to make sure you're in good alignment or good collimation in order to get a good clear image, to get the best from your telescope. Now, collimation isn't scary, it's just like adjusting your seat and mirrors in your car every time you get in. But we're going to cover it in another video because there are quite a few steps to go through to do the job properly. The good thing is that the topic is included in the instruction manual, so you can have a look over that. But I think we'll come to it later as it is a separate topic, but something that's quite important with all telescopes like this, that we need to make sure they're in good alignment. Okay, so that's the telescope unboxed and set up ready for use. First impressions are very good. The package contains everything you need to get started. It's small and light but not flimsy, and I'm impressed with the quality of the construction. It seems that for £140 or $200 you get a lot of telescope. So I think it's going to make a great first telescope. To be certain, please take a look at the first light video on my channel where we'll try out the telescope during the night. Thanks for watching. Please press the red subscribe button in order to get notifications of other videos on the Jenham's Astro channel.